Amen.
Good evening. It's almost Sabbath, so I still say happy Sabbath. Amen. So I want to preface this message because we know we're living in the time of the end, correct? These are established truths, and we know we are in the time of the end because of the way marks. And we can prove these things line upon line. And because of the way marks, we know when we can ask for the rain, because you have to ask for the rain in the time of the latter rain, correct? So this particular message, same with a few added details from the camp meeting, but this is being attacked right now. We understood what happened to Joel, right? We see what's been going on with the Eastern question, right? But now this is being attacked. 1989, just this week. So as we're getting light, the devil is pouring out his falsehood, his lying spirit on his people. As of this week, people that used to be in this message are saying that 1989 is not a way mark. As of this week. It's unbelievable. So we have to hold on to these way marks because this is how you know the rain is coming. There's a time, there's a generation in which God said he's going to finish the work. Without this, you're still here. Where are we? Where is the Sabbath here? Where's the perfect character of God being fulfilled in his people walking in all truth? Where's the 144,000 here? You see that? So this is being attacked by people that used to be in this message because they stepped off and didn't follow on in the advancing light. Now they're denying the things that they used to believe in. That just this week, this is happening. So though this is, for me personally, I just spoke on it recently, but I'm seeing how vital this is. Because if you reject the foundations, you have nothing. You fall into the wicked world below. So there are people, and this is nothing to rejoice about. These are souls who Satan is attacking, and if they have a hard path to come back on this message. So we definitely need to be praying and petitioning God that we have to follow the Lamb whithersoever he goes. So, as you're looking at your notes, in the back of, I believe the top of my notes, it says a revolution last crisis, but the notes are in reverse order. So it's actually the third set of notes within that stapled package, and it begins binding off Millerites a type. It's three separate notes in one packet, so that they're numbered according to the study. So, on page one of that study, it said, message of 1798, a type of 1989. Okay, so what is established in Adventism is that William Miller was given the light on the end of the world. And 1996, we know according to the line, 1996 marks the light for the end of the world, right? And we recognize this because of the light that came on the Sunday law in 1996. And this light was the light that was about to, that God was given to the world based upon 1989, the first angel's message arriving. And this angel arrives, God is starting to do a work in his people. This is the last generation marked in 1989. So we know those things. So let's just have that laid out here. 1798, William Miller, this is the first angel's message arrived in history. And then 1816, 1818 is when William Miller began to study. And then we have these other waymarks, right? These are established truths. And so we understand this is the time of the end because of Daniel 11, verse 40, when the king of the north will come against the king of the south like a whirlwind. These are established truths. And then God places his manservant here, and he gives us the light for the end of the world. And then we have these other waymarks. So I have these pointed because this is the next waymark for the priests. And this is the light that we have to be focusing on because this is the next waymark. As we used to believe on a general scale, it was Sunday law. And then just recently, it was midnight cry. And then now we're seeing this. So we're not moving any waymarks, but God has given more light to prepare people. So with that said, we're going to look at these notes. And during the time of the Millerites, we know that the messages that led to the time of the end was 25, 20, 2300 days, 1335, etc. And in our time, we have these same messages coming back to light. The 2520 has come back to light, and God has given us more understanding on all these truths. So we're going to look at Great Controversy 335, and it's in your notes. It says, at the very time specified, and this is dealing with the number four, at the very time specified, Turkey, through her ambassadors, accepted the protection of the Allied powers of Europe and thus placed herself under the control of Christian nations. The event exactly fulfilled the prediction. When it became known, multitudes were convinced of the correctness of the principles of prophetic interpretation adopted by Miller and his associates, and a wonderful impetus was given to the Advent movement. Men of learning and position united with Miller both in preaching and publishing his views, and from 1840 to 1844, the work rapidly extended. So we know that this date right here, August 11th, 1840, it said this was William Miller's rules were confirmed during this time, right? And so William Miller began to study during this time in 1883. That's another significant time here. But William Miller began to study. He established these rules of prophetic interpretation. And William Miller's rules were confirmed by Islam being restrained, right? That's Millerite history. So their message was based upon the 391-year 15-day prophecy, which William Miller established. Well, he didn't establish that prophecy, but his rules led to the understanding of the prophecy and its fulfillment. So in 1840 to 44 is one of the ways we established the binding off because of the number four. So understanding the events of prophecy is connected to number four, right? Because this is what the Millerites did. They look for, the Bible said this. How is this being fulfilled in prophecy? They didn't take an event and say, okay, this event, that's how the Bible is saying. No, it's that the Bible gives us the information, and then we look for that event in history and see how God has laid it out. Because God's word dictates prophecy, right? I mean, God's word dictates the events of prophecy, right? God's word dictates events. Events do not dictate God's word. Amen? So, now this impetus is given. It says a wonderful impetus was given to the Advent movement. So we see connected with William Miller's understanding, his rules, you have a time period of 1840 to 44 based upon William Miller's rules. You see that? Okay. So, but this impetus came in steps. Josiah Litch in 1838 made a prediction about Islam being restrained. And then on 10 days before the event happened, he gave an exact date saying when this restraining would happen. So, and this was Turkey accepting the protection of the Allied powers. And this is also a restraint. That's why we use this waymark in our history. So this message was the impetus that drew people in. So once people saw this message, which was based upon what William Miller began to understand here, people started to come in between 1840 to 44, right? That's the prophet of the Lord is saying. So the principles of Miller's principles of prophetic interpretation were confirmed. So that's what we're drawing out here. We want to focus on this point and leading to this point right here. So that's why I have these little dashes around it. So line upon line with 1840, Midnight Awakening. About the middle of July, the blessing of God and reclaiming backsliders began to attend the proclamation of the time. And those who embraced either of the views referred to manifested a marked change in their deportment and a sudden waking out of sleep, as was predicted. At midnight, there was a cry made, "Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him." Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. From July, these movements were in different parts of New England and distinct from one another, but they were all attended by the blessing of God and reclaiming many whose lamps had well nigh gone out, and in the sanctification of the saints. At the Exeter camp meeting, all these influences met, mingled into one great movement and rapidly spread throughout all the Advent bands in the land. So, Millerite's message, it was a message based upon time. It was based upon 1840, and it was based upon the foundation laid by Miller. And at the Exeter camp meeting, all the influences of the past met and mingled and spread through all the Advent bands. So at the Exeter camp meeting, which was Midnight Crown there, the influences of the past met and mingled. So, and what she starts off in this paragraph, so this wasn't her, this wasn't Sister White. But it says, about the middle of July, the blessing of God and reclaiming backsliders began to attend the proclamation of time. So this middle of July, this was July 21st, when Samuel Snow first preached the Midnight Cry message. So you see, we have, during Millerite time, and I'm emphasizing this so much because people, Satan is trying to move the waymarks, but the middle of July, right, God, the blessing of God and reclaiming backsliders began to attend the proclamation of the time. So all the influences that came to the Midnight Cry, the past events led to this, right? So we're going to hone in on this midnight point right there. So the midnight of the message, and it's from the Great Second Advent Movement, page 162 on page 2 of your notes. The midnight of the message. How long is the tarrying time? Half a year. How do you know? Because our Lord says, at midnight, while the bridegroom tarried, the vision was for 2,300 evening mornings or days. An evening or night is half of one of those prophetic days and is therefore 6 months. That is the whole length of the tarrying time. The present strong cry of time commenced about the middle of July and has spread with great rapidity and power and is attended with a demonstration of the Spirit such as I never witnessed when the cry was 1843. It is now literally, go ye out to meet him. There is a leaving all that I never dreamed could be seen. When this cry gets hold of the heart, farmers leave their farms with their crops. There is a strong crying with tears and a consecration of all to God, such as I never witnessed. There is a confidence in this truth, such as was never felt in the previous cry, in the same degree, and a weeping or melting glory in it that passes all understanding except to those who have felt it. So, the tarrying time in this quote is marked as 6 months, right? And we know this, the tarrying time in our history, we already established as 9/11 to the Sunday law. But we get these waymarks because in Millerite history, the 6 months they marked was from, which I don't have on, I don't have April 19th on here, but the 6 months was from April 19th, 1844 to October 22nd, 1844. That's how the Millerites looked at the 6 months. Because from the first day of the first month to the 10th day of the seventh month is 6 months. Everyone see that? Okay. So now the commencement of the strong cry, according to this quote, began in the middle of July. All right. So we know there's a midnight cry, but there's a commencement of a strong cry that begins in the middle of July. That's the midnight waymark we have there. And there's no cry like this since 43. Right. Now we know 1843 and 1844, they touch according to the 1335 prophecy. So this is marking the first day of the first month. So there's no cry like this cry for midnight there's no cry like it. The 1843 cry connects us to 9/11. I'm trying to say it correctly. So there's the 9/11. In other words, the 9/11 cry doesn't compare to this cry. The message that drew us in, the calling of the virgins. Now God is saying, okay, I'm about to seal this thing up. I'm about to wrap it up. So this cry exceeds that. And I'm struggling with words to describe that. So also, within this 6 months, a total consecration to God happens, right? And we already know that, according to Sister White, at the midnight cry, you had a people totally consecrated to God. These people were ready to be translated. They were walking in all the light they had. They was ready to go home because they understood that Jesus was coming. So it's within this 6 month time frame that a total consecration to God happens. And this is our experience that takes us to midnight. So if people say there's no 1989, where's the total consecration to God in our line? Right? How can you prove it? Otherwise, you'd just be giving your opinion versus giving waymarks that we look for and which we know that they enable us to ask for the rain, right? So now the parables are the foundation. I left my Bible on the table. I'll grab my Bible. So we're going to go to Matthew 13. Thank you. Parables are the foundation, and this is key. And I think if you look at the recent camp meeting, look at Brother Deontay's presentation on Genesis 24, he really lays out how the Father and the Son, they work in this relationship, and God's manservant is used in this relationship. All right. So basically what it is, Abraham asks his servant to go find a bride for his son. Abraham representing the Father, Isaac representing the Son. Isaac is the promise. And that's key, because we're going to find out later how Isaac, we're going to see Abraham and Sarah here and Abraham and Sarah here. But Isaac has to go, the servant has to go get the bride for Isaac, right? And then at each one of these steps, Rebecca is found, right? So we're going to see that. I'm not going to go through Genesis 24, but if you watch his presentation, he lays that out beautifully. So we're going to look at the parables and hone in on 1996. So Matthew 13, verse 34 through 35, it says, "All these things spake Jesus unto the multitude in parables, and without a parable spake he not unto them, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things which have been kept secret from the foundation of the world." So Jesus did not speak without a parable, according to what the Bible says, right? So everything he spoke was a parable. "That it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things which have been kept secret from the foundation of the world." Okay, so many ways we could look at this, but I know at the foundation of the world, I wasn't here. All right? And looking at you guys' faces, none of you are that old to say you were there, right? So these things that are kept secret from the foundation, we're going to find out what those things are. So the word secret, just a little bit of looking at the Hebrew and Greek words, secret means concealed, hide, to be hid, that it may not be known. So God hid these things. He could have gave them to Abraham. He could have gave them to Daniel. He could have gave them to Paul, but he's giving it to us, right? Amen? So foundation means laying down. And laying down, and it's a couple of different ways to look at this, but laying down what the architect gives you. That's how I'm seeing it. Because we know in the seven thunders, you have Manasseh, Ammon, then Josiah. Ammon is the architect. Josiah is the next when he lays down the foundation, which connects 1996 and 1989. But we'll see that. So Josiah is marked in 1996 in the line of the seven thunders. So I'm put Josiah. And So Josiah's laying down. We understand the foundation is also at 9/11. Early writings 2:29, bottom of page 2. It says, and remember, we're dealing with this keeping secret from the foundation of the world. The things that God has spoken, he's kept secret. So God sent his angel to move upon the heart of a farmer who had not believed the Bible, to lead him to search the prophecies. Angels of God repeatedly visited that chosen one to guide his mind and to open his understanding and open to his understanding prophecies which had ever been dark to God's people. So I keep reading. The commencement of the chain of truth was given to him, and he was led on to search for link after link until he looked with wonder and admiration upon the word of God. He saw there a perfect chain of truth, that the word which he had regarded as uninspired now opened before his vision in its beauty and glory. He saw that one portion of scripture explains another. And when one passage was closed to his understanding, he found in another part of the word that which explained it. He regarded that sacred word of God with joy and with the deepest respect and awe. As he followed down the prophecies, he saw that the inhabitants of the earth were living in the closing scenes of this world's history. So we're going to look at this a little bit deeper. So it says that the prophecies which had been dark, ever dark to God's people, and William Miller saw by studying the prophecies, he saw that they were living in the closing scenes of this world's history. So in Millerite history, they understood that this was the close of probation. They thought this was the end of the world, right? We all know that. So, but it was the prophecies that led them to that understanding. Because at midnight, in the midnight cry, we understand that there was a people prepared. They were totally consecrated to God. And at the midnight cry, all those past influences met at the midnight cry. And at the midnight cry, you had a people that was perfectly ready to go to heaven. They were walking in all the light they had. So, Psalms 18, verse 11. It says, he made darkness his secret place. His pavilion round about him were dark waters and thick clouds of skies. So in here, darkness means, is the Hebrew word H02822. And darkness means obscurity, concealed, or ignorance. And secret place means covering or secrecy. So in taking this line upon line, we see that the prophecies that had been dark to God's people were concealed, because darkness is meaning concealing. So when does God open these things up to us? He opens them up to us because if this is, Josiah is laying down the foundation, which parallels William Miller's studies here, this message that came here is the foundation that's given to us at the end of the world because it establishes the message. The first angel's message comes, William Miller's given a message, and he sees October 22nd, 1844, based upon the 2520 and the 2300 day prophecy. First angel's message arrives here, 1996 comes, what does he see? Sunday law. You see that? And we know the Sunday law is also the close of probation because after this point, after each nation makes its national Sunday law, once that last nation makes it, then you have the close of probation, or the Sunday law is now universal. But the United States forces every nation to make a national Sunday law. And when that last one makes it, now that's the close of probation. So we see, just to repeat again, William Miller, he sees the close of probation. Here, God's servant sees the Sunday law, right? But we see in William Miller's time, before they got to the Sunday law, some influences met here, but here they were totally consecrated to God. So here, the message come, it's pointing to here, because this is what we have to get ready for. We see this, but this is based upon this, and here we have a total consecration to God. You see that line upon line? Amen. Praise the Lord. So parables are midnight for a priest, for the priest. We're going to look at the rebellion and binding off. And I didn't state earlier that these three particular studies, they're building upon one another. So the next two studies are going to be based upon this one, is laying the foundation. So rebellion and binding off. 13 is rebellion. And understanding what we know now about, I'm not going to get into it too much, about the French Revolution and the American Revolution, we can bring in this line based on knife testimonies and a number of other places in connecting the French Revolution, but the French Revolution was based upon the American Revolution. And we know that in the American Revolution, the 13 colonies rebelled against Britain. They were rebelled against the Pope and England, the state, right? So in going to Genesis 17, this is an interesting line. Genesis 17. Verse 23 through 26. And it's some information in here, and I'm going to share it in my next study. But it's very powerful, and it really brings this Genesis 17 to light. And it really blows it up. And we see a certain truth that I know I have struggled with, but God is good, and He opens it up. So in verses 23 through 26, and this is when Abraham, you know, God had came to him and told him he's going to have a son and all of this. So we'll deal with verse 23. It says, Abraham took Ishmael, his son, and all that were born in his house, and all that were bought with his money, every male among the men of Abraham's house, and circumcised the flesh of their foreskin in the selfsame day, as God had said unto him. And Abraham was 90 years old and 9 when he was circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin. And Ishmael, his son, was 13 years old when he was circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin. And the selfsame day, Abraham was circumcised and Ishmael, his son. So here we have a 13 marking a binding off for Abraham. So my point is that I want to show you the number 13. We're going to prove it later. But this is the same day that Abraham fell on his face and he laughed. And we know there's a falling on your face at the midnight cry and humbling yourself in the dust, right? So all that's there in Genesis 17, but we're going to prove that more later. Genesis 14, 1 through 4. It says, we're just going to look for, trying to identify the number 13 with rebellion. And it came to pass in the days of, oh, I don't know none of these names. Amraphel, king of Shinar, Arioch, king of Elasar, Shadar Lomar, king of Elam, and Tidal, king of nations. We'll skip to verse 4 this time. Then it says, 12 years they served Shadar Lomar, and in the 13th year they rebelled. So we have 13 marking rebellion. Do you see that? Okay. And we know Revelation 13, that's the great chapter of rebellion. America, it was the beast with two lamb-like horns, and then they speak as a dragon, the papacy uprise. We know Revelation 13 is a chapter of rebellion, right? But also the number 30 is the number for the priests on a number of lines. Number 30 is marked at this point because of, you can identify 508 to 538, it's a number of 30s there. But 30 is the age of the priests when they could begin to serve, right? And just to put this out there, number 25 was the age of the Levites. Hopefully I'm not mixing those up. Okay. All right, so 25 was the number of the Levites. Now, we understand that the priests and the Levites, they were the leadership, so to speak, of the nation, right? Now, when you look at the Congress, it's made up of the senators and the House of Representatives, right? So they get this from the Bible. But they pick their ages for the minimum age you have to be before you can serve is 30 for the senators and 25 for the House of Representatives. And what's interesting, if we're marking these points here, right, we know this is a midnight cry is a Sunday law because marriage and Sabbath are twin institutions. It's the legislative branch of the United States that makes laws. Right? So we have 25 and 30 marked in this time frame from midnight to midnight cry. And we have the legislative branch of the United States is going to make a law here, of course, they're egged on by the Protestant churches to make a Sunday law, but that's not a coincidence, and that's in the Constitution. If you look at the Constitution, I forget which, but it's early on, which amendments, but it actually says that in the Constitution, the ages. So God established this thousands of years ago, right? So, and that's in Numbers 4, 3, and Numbers 8 also, I forget, 8:24, I believe. And we know Judas' 30 pieces of silver marks rebellion. So now we're going to take an example of this. We're going to look at this number 13 and the number 30 in the four Gospels. So we'll look at Matthew 13, 30, Mark 13, 30, Luke 13, 30, and John 13, 30. And I've just been finding out God is... with every number you see nowadays, it means something in the Bible. It could be number 312 or whatever. Every number means something. And I'm seeing that more and more and more with every number you see. So none of this is happenstance. That's why God is the wonderful number. He can do this. Only his mind can do this. So, and he had it written. This is the Glorious Land's language, right? The King James Bible, right? So this, he did that with this Bible. Other Bibles you can't do that with. Other languages you can't even do that with. So, and that's why they want to translate King James Version to other versions, so to other languages as best they can. So Matthew 13, verse 30 says, "Let both grow together until the harvest. And at the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares, and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barns." So we know that the tares are bound first, correctly? Correct? And this, we identify this as the binding off. All right? And the tares are bound first, the tares have to fall away first. But the Bible is saying that you have to gather the wheat for the harvest, right? This was a harvest here because you have people totally consecrated to God. You cannot harvest anything until it's ready. In Millerite time, God had a people that was ready. So in our time, God is going to have a people that is ready. So Mark 13, 30. And it says, "Verily I say unto you, that this generation shall not pass till all these things be done." Now, all four of these chapters, all of them are actually dealing with literally parables, things that you actually say, you can identify that as a parable, right? So as you go through these chapters, you'll see this. But Mark 13:30 says, "Verily I say unto you, that this generation shall not pass till all these things be done." Which generation is this? Right? And God visits the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generation, right? So God is going to wrap up things in the fourth generation. We can identify that we're in the fourth generation. And we identify that we are, not them, we are in the fourth generation, line upon line. But when you remove 1989, you're not even in the fourth generation. You can't claim any promises because you've removed the waymarks. You cannot ask for the rain. So this understanding of this line is vital. It is salvific. So Luke 13, 30. In each four of these verses are just identifying things that we readily understand. Luke 13, 30. "And behold, there are last which shall be first, and there are first which shall be last." Now, just on a common, without going into it too much, on a surface level, even, I teach this to my children. I have three daughters, and one daughter wants something so bad, the other wants something. I'm like, well, somebody has to give. Somebody has to die to yourself, right? Because you both can't do this thing at the same time. So this one is marking, at least in my mind, at least pride, right? And we know that pride is the first curse of the 2520, right? So this is dealing with our sins. So, and we'll see from Christ Object Lessons, chapter 14, another time, but this is dealing with pride. If you don't overcome the first sin of the 2520, so in other words, if you don't even accept the 2520 as a truth, you don't even know what sins you need to put away in order to be fit for this. It's impossible. Rejecting the 25/20 makes it impossible for you to understand Bible truth to the point where it will sanctify you. It's impossible. Because it's light. If you reject light, you're walking in darkness. If Jesus takes you this way and you say, well, I was following you up until that point, I'm going to go this way on that one, you're walking in darkness. So if Jesus opens up the light, we have to accept that light and walk in the advancing light. So for anyone that doesn't accept the 25/20, they never get past first base. They never get there. So this pride is a sin that we have to put away here. So it's marked. It's identified there. And I'm making that distinction because in some of the wording that we use that's been going around lately, you know, there's a distinction between, you know, are you perfect at midnight or are you perfect before midnight, right? But we know as a Christian, you have to put away all your sin now because you could die when you get in the parking lot, right? So what we're saying by this, I think the proper way to word it, is that you putting away every known sin. We could prove it's every known sin. Everything that God has revealed to you, you put away here, everything, right? And here we know that we're going to say, woe is me, right? I'm a man of unclean lips. So there are still things we have to work out here, but you've put away your sin. And because just like in Miller, history, they put away their sin. They didn't have the Sabbath, but they had a people totally consecrated to God here. They put away every known sin and walked in all the light. So every ray of light that God gives us up until this point, we have to walk in it. And it's going to cause you to put away sin. That's what God's word does. It causes the day star to rise in your heart. So this is what this is. We put away every single known sin here. We haven't put away all sin because you don't know it. But you will never sin again because when that temptation comes, God is going to make you successful in it, right? Even Christ, he had to put away temptation his entire life, right? So we're going to put away every known sin here. And then every temptation that comes, like, Lord, I didn't know that was in me, but we're going to pass the test. Amen. You see that? Amen. That's great news, sister. Amen. So John 13:30. And this one is, when I went through each one of these, I don't even know I don't remember how the Holy Spirit impressed me to do that, but this one sealed the deal for me, John 13:30. It says, he then, having received the sop, went immediately out, and it was night. Now, we know this was midnight, right, according to the prophetic narrative. Now, what's interesting, it says, and he then, having received the sop, that's the spirit of prophecy, right? Right? He went immediately out, and it was night. Judas was amongst the 12, right? So, this is a warning for us, because that means Judas is still here, because Judas hadn't put away all his sin. He had many opportunities, but he did not put away his sin. So if we don't put away our sin, right, all our known sin to here, we're going to go out, we're going to betray God, right? We're going to betray those that we love, and we will be an enemy of God from this point. And this is hard for somebody to say as a human being, but we have the promise that as you teach and you share these things, holy angels will pour out oil into your heart and expel sin from your heart, right? So that's the beauty in sharing it. So every opportunity we get to study together, we need to be doing this sharing, because angels are going to give us the oil and they're going to expel sin from our heart. That's a promise. And I can show anybody the quote for that. Okay, we're going to look at the numbers 18. And this is going to go to Luke 13, and this is one of the things I added. I'm going to go to Luke 13, verse 1 through 5, and then 11 through 16. And the reason these people are really rejecting 1989 is because they want to reject this. I'm not ashamed to say it, but these people really hate Jeff Pippinger. That's a big part of their issue, right? And it's not that Jeff Pippinger is more special than you or me, but God chose him, right? So God chose him. He chose Moses. He chose a bunch of people in the Bible. God used him to lead. He can't choose everybody. He has to choose somebody. So he chose him. So be it. No need to be jealous. I want to go to heaven, right? That's the bottom line. So they want to reject this. That's why the rebels during this time, they brought up Louis Weir and say, oh, you didn't do this. It was Louis Weir first. But now they're rejecting this because they want to totally destroy this line. But we're going to prove this line and establish it in Luke 13 and Mark 13. So in Luke 13, verse 1 through 5, and I want you to pay attention to the number 18 in this chapter. And I'll actually do that because you guys are going to find more stuff than I found already. It says, then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for him to hear. Here, page is turning. Wait, I'm sorry. And I'm reading the wrong chapter anyway. I was in Luke 15. I meant Luke 13, I'm sorry. Luke 13, 1 through 5, and then we're going to jump to 11 through 16. Now, this is not in your notes. This is an addition. I'm sorry. This is an addition. Luke 13, 1 through 5, and it says, there were present at that season some that told him of the Galileans, whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. And Jesus answering said unto him, suppose ye that these Galileans were sinners above all the Galileans, because they suffered such things. I tell you, nay, but except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. Or those 18 upon whom the tower of Siloam fell, and slew them. Think ye that they were sinners above all men that dwelt in Jerusalem? I tell you, nay, except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. So we see, and I've identified chapter 13 and verse 30 as marking this time period. But here we have repentance mark, right? So he said, unless ye repent, right? So I could probably mark on either side. I'll put it here for now. So unless ye repent, you will likewise perish. But, and my daughter pointed this out to me as we were doing it for worship. She said, Daddy, that's a doubling. In verse 3 and verse 5, and I had to read it again, like, it sure is a doubling. He repeats the same exact thing. So this number 18 here is connected with repentance. So unless you repent, you're going to fall like those other, right? Like those other 18. So we have this 18, in which I didn't emphasize it earlier, but Deuteronomy 18:18 identifies the man that's going to bring the message, right? And so this was we saw this as William Miller. And I'm placing this here in 1996, and this is going to prove it even more. But this is the man that God is using to bring the message. So hopefully I was clearing that. So now we're going to go to verse 11 through 16. And it says, and behold, there was a woman which had a spirit of infirmity. How many years? 18 years. And was bowed together, and could in no wise lift up herself. And when Jesus saw her, he called her to him, and said unto her, woman, thou art loose from thine infirmity. And he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight, and glorified God. And the ruler of the synagogue answered with indignation, because that Jesus had healed on the Sabbath day, and said unto the people, there are 6 days in which men ought to work. In them therefore come and be healed, and not on the Sabbath day. Then the Lord answered him and said, thou hypocrite, doth not each of you on the Sabbath loose his ox or his ass from the stall and lead him away to watering? So then verse 16, and ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan have bound, lo, these 18 years, be loose from this bond on the Sabbath day? So here we have a loosing, right? Can you guys see that or no? It's probably too small. Repentance. A-N-C, I believe. Loosing. There's a loosing from infirmities also, all right? So that's talking to us. We are going to be not free from sin as you've never sinned, but if you're faithful, you're going to pass the test, right? That's the point. And you're going to pass the test because you've accepted this message that came. You see that connection? So this message is going to give light to here, but then it's going to have a people that's totally consecrated here, but they began being totally consecrated here. So we're going to be loose from our infirmity. It's sin that enslaves us, right? We're going to be loose from the slavery of sin, right? Because we're going to have the victory. Not that you've already had it, but when the test comes, you're going to be victorious, right? So then it says, woman, thou art loose from thy infirmity. And he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight. Isn't this where the touches are marked in Daniel? In Daniel 10? And she was made straight and glorified God. Right? And the ruler of the synagogue answered with indignation. And then it says, verse 15, the Lord answered him and said, thou hypocrite, doth not each one of you on the Sabbath loose his ox or his ass from the stall? So there's a loosing of an ass here, right? So she was loose from her infirmities, and there's a loosing of the ass there, right? I didn't see that, but my sister said, so that's a doubling also. Loose, loose. And then you also have the enemies, right? Bigthan and Teresh, right? Here in the Pharisees, they challenging Christ. Like, how do you do this, right? So we have the Bigthan and Teresh marked there from Esther. So all of these things are making sense, and you could place these on the lines because of this structure. Right? So we're going to go to Mark 13. I'll lay out this other line. Well, I didn't even put a bowing. There's a bowing here. Okay, Mark 13. We're going to walk through this in kind of the similar way we did Luke 13. And we're going to see some more indicators of where we are. Mark 13, verse 1 and 2. And these were actually cut off from your notes. I apologize. I sent everything but one page to these notes. But Mark 13, verse 1 through 2. It says, as he went out of the temple, one of his disciples said unto him, Master, see what manner of stones and what buildings are here? And Jesus answering said unto him, Seest thou these great buildings? There shall not be left one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. I'm going to look at 1 Peter chapter 2 and see what these stones are. And it's a lot of, it's another key point in here, and it's dealing with the elect. And if you could put that on your tabletop, and remember this is talking about the elect, because we're going to deal with the elect in part. But 1 Peter chapter 2, it says, Wherefore laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speaking, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby. If so be ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious, to whom coming as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious. Ye also as lively stones are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. So verse 5 identifies the lively stones as us, right? But the first stone was Christ. And it says that he was chosen of God. We know we're called, then we're going to be chosen and faithful, right? Verse 6, Wherefore also it is contained in the scripture, Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Unto you, therefore, which believe, he is precious, but unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto they also were appointed. So you have the elect and you have disobedience here. So if you're disobedient in the time that leads up to here, you're going to reject Christ. He said he was the stone that was disallowed. So they reject Christ here. So and the point was those stones we are the stone. So going back to Mark 13, it says, when you see it, seest thou these great buildings, shall there not be left one stone upon another? So we know that we are the stones, right? So, and the stones that are going to be left not one to another. Here, they're not going to stand on each other. Right? We have to understand the word for ourselves at that point. Amen. So here, I'll put the stones on top of each other. And we understand here that this is when the virgins are called. And we have to understand the message for ourselves rather than having our structure dictate to us what the truth is. You have to understand it for yourselves. And in Type, we know the leadership was bypassed here, right? And they were bypassed here just like the leadership during the Christ Day, because they were not delivering the truth. God had wanted to use them, but he couldn't. So he had to raise up John the Baptist, right? So anyway, so these stones is identifying a people that's going to accept the chief cornerstone, which is Christ, right? And they are going to stand, be able to stand for themselves and defend the scriptures, rather than having the safety in numbers and just saying, well, you know, I send off signs of the times to my family, and signs of the times is such a deep message. But you're going to be able to explain to them those things that they need to hear versus sending them a magazine. You are going to be able to work, and the Lord's going to use you to pierce hearts versus just sending a magazine. He's going to be Christ in us, the hope of glory, right? Yeah. Amen. So verses 3 and 4. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives over against the temple, Peter and James and John and Andrew asked him privately. Now, what two things do we see there? An inquiry. We have that marked, right? Mm-hmm. I'm going to put it down here. It's right big. Inquiry. So what else do we have? How many disciples were there?
Two.
Four disciples are listed there. Peter, James, John, and Andrew. And we have this structure when you bring in the trumpets. But the number four is also identified from here to here, just like in Millerite time, those here to here. But it was this message that brought about this four-year time frame. So what he established, William Miller established here, it led to this event, which led to total consecration to God there. And Midnight to Midnight Cry is also marked by the number four. And they ask, what shall be the sign when all these things shall be fulfilled, right? So we know there's a sign there also. We're running out of space, but there's a sign there. And looking at the French Revolution, we understand there's a sign. Verse 5 and 6. And Jesus answering them began to say, take heed lest any man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. This is a false latter rain message, right? And so we have the false latter rain message, which is the third message, because the fourth message is the bowing down to the sun, which is the Sunday law. And we know these are types, but how did it word it? Forgot that quickly. And many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. So we know there's a deception by Satan done here. So this is a false latter rain message, which we have marked at the midnight cry. And we understand this is a point in the period. Let's put a false message. Verses 7 and 8. It says, and we shall hear wars and rumors of wars. Be ye not troubled, for such thing must needs be, but the end shall not be yet. For a nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And there shall be earthquakes in diverse places, and there shall be famines and troubles. These are the beginnings of sorrows. So it's saying this binding off time period, this is the beginning of sorrows. This is the woman about to give birth. This fruit is about to come, right? This is going to be the promise seed of Abraham is going to come out of this, right? This great multitude, this people that even the sands of the see, you can't even number the people. This is this woman that's about to give birth, and it's because of this message, because you're going to have people totally consecrated to God from this midnight point. And this nation rising against nation, this is also a theme that we've been studying. You know, wars and the French Revolution and this, you know, United Nations coming on the scene. So verse 9 said, "But take heed to yourselves, for they shall deliver you up to councils, and in the synagogue you shall be beaten, and you shall be brought before rulers and kings for my sake, for a testimony against them." Now, there's many lines of during this time period that someone is brought to a king. Joseph is an example when he's brought to Pharaoh, and this is also during the same time period. Verse 10. And the gospel must first be published among all nations. And we understand that if it's the, you're brought to the rulers and kings, this is also marking a persecution time frame. You know, Christ was brought to Herod. You know, this is persecution. He brought to the ruler, the leadership of that day. So we know that it's persecution that causes the gospel to go forward. So at this midnight time frame, when God has a people, they begin to be persecuted, just like in the book of Acts, where the children of Israel, the Jews at that time that accepted Christ began to be persecuted, and then the gospel spread. So just like what we read in Millerite history, during this time, this was the impetus that caused the message to go to all the Advent bands. So this message during our time is going to go to all the Advent bands, right? So verse 11. "But when they shall lead you and deliver you up, take no thought beforehand what you shall speak, neither do you premeditate, but whatsoever shall be given you in that hour that ye speak, for it is not ye that speak, but the Holy Ghost," right? This is the Holy Spirit. This is the Mara vision. We're going to meet Christ, and he gives Daniel, he touches his lips, right? And then Daniel can speak. So the Holy Spirit is going to give us, that was the second touch, I believe, and God is going to touch us, right? And he's going to cause us to have a message that we can give to the world. And this is all during that binding off time period. In that hour. In that hour. Amen. Amen. And this is the day, the month, the year, the month, the day, and the hour also. So, amen. The hour is powerful. Verse 12. And this is where we see civil war. "Now the brother shall betray the brother to death, and the father the son, and the children shall rise up against their parents and shall cause them to be put to death." Now the brother betraying brother, that's within a family, right? This is in-house fighting. This is a civil war, which we're marking is being typified by the French Revolution also, which is during this time. But then it says something, and children shall rise up against their parents and shall cause them to be put to death. In my mind, this brings the image test to light, because it was during, and what I mean by image was when Rome set up their image in 66 AD, and then they came back in 70 AD, and then the people began to, they were eating each other. Right? Parents, children, I just can't even imagine it. But this, the point, like, we have to grapple with this. You're an unconverted mind if you eat your child, right? If this is 66, right? I know how to put it. 66, and this is 70, right? So if we fail this test, if we don't see the image, if we don't flee, right? Then, and you have to flee before this, because you have to see the sign, right? So you don't see the sign here, and this is a point in a period, so really here, you're going to be totally given over to Satan, to the point you would eat your child. You would eat the fruit of your womb. A mother would eat the fruit of her womb. This will happen in literal history. You know, it happened in ancient history too. I think it was Benadiab, I forget the king's name, but that woman came to him. She was on the wall, and he rode by, and he asked her, "What's wrong?" She said, "We boiled my child," and all this, and just a sick story. But the Bible's giving us this information because this is what will happen, right? So, verse 13 and 14. "And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, But he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. But when you shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet stand where it ought not, let him that readeth understand. I'm sorry, lost one. Let him that readeth understand. Then let them which be in Judea flee to the mountain. So this is another point. So if you're in Judea, and you have to flee to the mountain, right? So we have 66 marked at midnight, 70 marked at 70, 70 years marked at midnight cry. But he said, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by the prophet Daniel, right, standing where ought not, let him understand that let them which be in Judea flee to the mountains, right? So what is the mountain? The mountain is God's glorious holy mountain, the church, right? Right. In Judea, you have to leave and go to the mountain. Judea is representing Jerusalem or the city or the people of God, right? So during this time here, we're going to be proclaiming a message somehow by God's power. When you see this, you have to flee to the mountain, right? So this is a message in part to the Levites because they have to be warned. So in order to flee to the mountains, you have to leave Judea. Judea is the structure right here. The living stones, these are the mountain, right? This is Daniel 2. This is that image, that stone hidden in the feet, right? This is God's people at the end of the world. This is God establishing his kingdom. So the Levites have to flee this structure, if they held on to, and come to the mountain where God's truth is. Everyone see that? So verse 15. It said, and let him that is on the housetop go not down into the house, neither enter therein to take anything out of his house. And I want to read verse 16 also. And let them that is in the field turn not back again for to take up his garment. Now, the field is the church, according to Christ's object lessons, correct? Now, it says that you have to flee the housetop, no, not go down. You can't go in, can't take anything out of the house. And let him that is in the field not go back again to take up his garment. So these old garments that we used to have, this is where you see Mordecai. We're going to do Mordecai in the next study. But Mordecai has a change of garment after he perceives, right? So these Adventists, they are not going to go, they accept the message. They're not going to go and put back on those old garments. They're not going to go back into the house and take these old doctrines with them. They're going to walk in the truth that the glorious holy mountain gives them. So this garment that they put on is Christ's righteousness, because this is what Christ is going to give us here, right? It's not any of our doing. It's Christ. Everything is Christ. Everything is what he's doing. He's going to make us, because we've done everything we could. We've asked for it. We've asked for the rain. We've pleaded. We've forsaken every sin. God said, okay, you did it. Now I'm working. Now is the time. You're going to be faithful forever to not sin again. So another key part. Verse 16, in dealing with Mordecai did not take that garment from Esther during the same time frame. Esther tried to give him, because Mordecai was at the gate, she tried to give him the garment, but Mordecai refused, because he put on sackcloth and ashes. He had repented, he had put away sin. Esther, I'm sorry, you have to listen to what I'm saying, all right? You have to accept my message, because he said, you've been brought to the kingdom for such a time as this, right? And if you don't accept it, you will die. And then guess what Esther said? Well, if I perish, I perish, because I'm doing what God said do. And that's what's going to happen to the Levites. So, but it's if they have a Mordecai standing in the gate. So what time do I have to stop? Now? Oh, okay. Okay. I'm on the last few verses. I went fast. Verse 17. It says, but woe to them that are with child and to them they give suck in those days. And I'm still wrestling with this one, but the woe jumps out to me, because Islam, but woe to them that were with child, to them that give suck in those days. So the living stones, they're not going to be feasting on milk, off the breast. They're going to be eating the meat of God's word, right? This is prophecy. So, but there's a woe pronounced to those who are still on the milk. That's how I see it. I'm open for correction on that one. Amen. Because now you're looking like Rome. At midnight, Judas, he went out to hang himself, All right, because the devil entered into him. So at midnight, if you're not in this time of the priest, if we're not set firmly in the truth, we're going to look like Rome. So therefore, Islam can attack us because Islam is the scourge to Rome. So verse 18, it says, and pray that your flight be not in the winter. So Genesis 8:22 and Jeremiah 8:20. In these last three verses, Genesis 8:22 and then Jeremiah 8:20. Genesis 8:22 says, while the earth remaineth, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, and day and night shall not cease. So Genesis 8:22 is giving us seasons. It's called seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night, and day and night shall not cease. So we're going to compare that to Jeremiah 8:20, and we're going to look at the lines to see what this is telling us. Jeremiah 8:20 says, the harvest is past, the summer is ended, and we are not saved. Now, Genesis 8:22, it dealt with seed time and harvest, right? So in here, it's saying the harvest is past, the summer is ended, and we are not saved. So do we see the summertime on here? Yeah. July 21st, right? That's the summer, right? So the harvest is past, the summer is ended, right? So the summer is ended, we are not saved. We're going to have the mark of the beast if we don't repent here. You see that? Right, blocking the board. So the summer is past, the harvest is ended, we are not saved. So the summer is past, it's fall time, right? October 22nd was the fall, right? Sunday law is the fall, and we are not saved. So if we don't do this work here, this prophesying about here, which prepares us here, but has people totally consecrated here, we're going to receive that very curse that we were warned about here. Because this is the message that was warning us to flee, right? I'm saying you start to understand these things the more you explain them, because I don't think I understood it that way, so it just came out of my mouth. So, so verse 19 and 20, and dealing with the bounding off, we're just going to wrap this up, this last two verses. Matthew 13. Mark 13, I'm sorry. God is good. That just makes me laugh because I really didn't understand that like that until I said it. So praise the Lord. Amen. Verse 19. For in those days shall be affliction, such as was not from the beginning of the creation of God, which God created until this time, neither shall be. We already learned that this message is the message from the foundation of the world. Nothing like this. So this is an affliction that has never been, right? It's a message that has never been, an affliction that has never been. And except that the Lord had shortened those days, no flesh should be saved. But for the elect's sake, that's me and you, whom he hath chosen, he hath shortened the days. And this is one of the key components, the key ways to identify the binding off. It's a shortening of days, right? Sister White talks about the time from 1260 year time frame, the persecution almost wholly ceased. This was 25 years from 1798 was 1773. That's 25, yeah. So, and this is 538. So this is how we identify this binding off in this time frame. So it's really sealing it for us that this is the time that all the parables are talking about. And this is this right here. So this is what we have to prepare for. And you only prepare for it by repenting and walking in the light. So you have to study and you have to apply what the studies is teaching. We cannot continue arguing. We have to fight. Sister White, when you're angry, Sister White said, don't say a word. Just shut up. I had to tell myself that, Richard, just shut up. Because I want to be sealed. Amen? So it's very practical. And you only see this through the lines. And it's, can't believe people are rejecting 1989 when there's all of this light there. So this is our great hope. Amen? Let's pray. Father in heaven, dear God, we thank you so much for this opportunity, Lord, to share in your word, Lord, to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Lord, we ask for the rain. And Lord, we ask you to energize us, Lord, as we go into this break. Lord, we pray as these Sabbath hours have come upon us, Lord, that our conversations would be reverent, Lord, and our words would be spoken in the fear of you, dear God. So bless us as we continue to study. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.